Get it done. Woo-hoo-hoo-hoo!
Kia ora tato. That was Big's Backyard Ultra, the Aotearoa edition. I'm Matt Raymond.
And I'm Eugene Bingham.
This is Dirt Church Radio. Interesting conversations with interesting runners.
Can what you hear got? That? What you got?
It's mail. It's lit. It is. In the first couple of episodes we ever did,
yep,
we pretended to open letters, this shoe company who was suing us. But this is an actual letter addressed to Dirt Church Radio at 5 Riverhead Street, Riverhead.
You don't want to talk about that being sued anymore.
No.
You have always have said.
But anyway, look, we'll open it. It is addressed to Dirt Church Radio.
It's literally opening a letter.
And literally,
it's got a stamp and everything.
It does. Oh, it says heart further faster. Something very cool. Oh, has it got? Oh, it's kind of sticky. But look, it looks like the front cover of National Geographic.
It does.
And it is Further Faster Volume 2. And Further Faster in Christchurch, New Zealand's ultimate independently owned outdoors retailer,
the bestest,
are having their new shop open this weekend, and they've busted and they took out their neighbours and they've opened the shop up, and it's really wide. And if you go down to 57A and B Buchan Street in Christchurch, you can hang out with them all the time.
Badger.
Go see Badger, go see Rocky.
Yeah.
And they say it's not just
Rocky featuring on the cover there.
Featuring on the cover. It's not just an outdoor store. We are outdoor gear haven made for you. So you did this, thank you. Oh, so good.
Wow.
Wish we were here with you guys, there with you guys. Further Faster, supporting us with the good gears and supporting you guys.
Mm, get amongst it.
Get amongst it.
Can't wait to get down there. Right. Wild Things.
Yes.
If you use the code
DCR2020.
Yes. You get 15 months with the price of 12. I know we keep banging on about that, but it's such a good deal.
Good community.
Good community.
Access to the trial directory.
Yep.
Access to gear, access to specials, access to
races. They're always giving away races.
Yep, they're really good races.
Really good races.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Get amongst it, people. DCR 2020, use that code. You can sign up to Wild Things. 15 months for a price of 12. Why wouldn't you? And we get a little kickback from it as well.
A little bit of a kickback there.
Yep. All right, cool.
Ultra Spire. You will notice a shuffling sea level dwelling herbivore in any of the promotional Fresh Choice Kepler Challenge. What pack is the natural pack of the Kepler Challenge? It's the Zygos 4, and you'll see a photo of yours truly wearing it going up to Mount Luxmore.
Not just wearing it, rocking it.
Well, we're rolling it than rocking it. But look, fantastic gear, fantastic packs. Ultraspire sponsor us, and we wear their gear and we love their gear. And if you go to ultraspire.nz, you're in luck, because the Zygos 4 is back in stock. And I've had plenty of people actually getting in touch with me going, do you really wear that pack? I'm like, I wear that pack a lot. And how good it is.
The Zygos is so good.
Yeah.
I've had three of them.
Yes, I've had two of them.
Mm.
Best iteration yet.
So good.
Dirt Radio.
Are you really ready?
I'm so ready to quit my job and go live in the woods with my family.
All right, okay. Yeah. Well, what about we just do episode 115 first?
We made it.
115. Wow.
Yep.
What a weekend.
What a weekend.
You had a bit of an adventure.
I had a bit of an adventure.
A bunch of super tough people ran around the Riverhead Forest.
Yep. That was a masterclass in resilience and adaptability.
Yep.
What else went on?
Well, we had an election.
We did. Yeah, we had a historic election.
We did. We had a test match rugby match against Australia. Who won that one?
I believe we did, quite convincingly.
Sorry, Aussie friends.
Yeah.
What a weekend.
Adam Keane, him of Aerobic Edge, the savage from the south, Crush of the Cargo, he won the Kiwi version of Big's Backyard Ultra Marathon International Showdown with 35 laps, with Glenn Sutton just smashing it out with him till the very end.
Yeah,
I was sitting at my desk refreshing my Google Docs thing every hour and wishing I was still out there, but ultimately reality reality called and we had to pull the pig. But we'll bring you all of that, all the results and background in.
Yep. You got some superb audio out there.
Yeah, I went and got some field recordings.
You did. Some of it, we've got a bit of wind noise and stuff, but it's good fun and it's real. It's authentic.
Yeah, it's authentic. It was really amazing to be out there.
Yeah. And so we'll bring that to you with all the results and stuff. And we're still frantically hitting refresh because the race continues.
Absolutely.
Overseas. So while we're
still several
down here,
who's still going?
Well, we'll come to it because
we'll come
change
to it
between
it's
now and then.
It will, you're right.
So let's do that. But your chat with Amy Sproston last week. Wow.
Yeah, she was amazing. I reflected on that over the week and her. Just how considered she was and at the same time very warm. And it was amazing thinking about what she was doing and some of the things that she pointed out, you know, when she said she went into the bar. Went into the McDonald's bathroom and so I went into McDonald's in Saudi Arabia and there was no woman's bathroom in the restaurant. Mm. That was really kind of jarring,
Yeah, but gave me lots of good memories of running in weird places, actually.
Yeah, it's to that. One thing I want to do more of is run in places further afield. But
yeah, Bamiyan was pretty special. but you know, it's good fun getting out and about.
What else we got going on?
Well, we got a special treat with some breaking news from allll.
Yeah,
something pretty amazing that's coming up.
We just spoke to him before we came on, and they have something pretty amazing
coming up. Pretty big, pretty wild.
Mm-hmm.
And, keep your ears out for that one, and of course that special coverage of the Flying Kiwis at Big's backyard. But first, how you been, man?
I'm in that really. And I haven't felt like this for ages, that part where you've been out in an event, you've done a bunch of running, you're a bit sore, you're a bit tired, and just, like I said before, wanting to quit your job and move into the forest, you know, to hang out all weekend with some people who I hadn't seen in a long time, or apart from you, I'd seen you a bunch, but my family, and watch and engage and sort of be a fan and be part of this amazing event around the world. So it was an amazing thing.
Yeah, how's the training going?
Training's going really well. Yeah, training is going really, really well. But it's amazing shifting into a focus. Like there's no off session. Everything has a meaning to it.
Yes.
You know, so.
Which is as training should be.
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, when you're focused on something, sometimes it's good just to have run for run's sake. But when you're focused on something, it's important to have every session meaning something, even if it just means this is a recovery session.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And that's been really encouraging, actually, just going out and going, I can allow myself to do this because this is what I'm supposed to be doing. So yeah, fantastic. Yep. No complaints at all. So and how have you been, man?
Well, funny old week for me,
Funny old week for me.
Got to hang out with you for a bit, which was really nice. I was on election duties over the weekend.
Yep.
Which was it was pretty full on.
Yeah.
Yeah, big old election here. And then got out to Riverhead on Sunday, which was epic. I loved it.
Yeah, it was amazing.
Yeah, it was good. It was good. And the weather was good. I was thinking, as I was walking up towards the event headquarters, I was thinking, imagine if it was raining and miserable here.
It would have been so awful.
But instead it was a nice day. It would have been freezing. And you come to this during the nighttime, but during the day it was lovely and warm. And it was a bit of a breeze, so it wasn't too hot, although I wasn't running lap after lap every hour. So, you know, it did all mean that I didn't get much running myself this week, but that's the way things go, right?
And I mean, now you're in the place, and for those of you who don't know, I mean, since early March, you've been doing 4 podcasts a week.
Yeah.
Sometimes. What's that, 200 Earth years? So, I mean, how you get a bit of a rest now?
Yeah. Certainly slowing down. And then I can get back into some other projects that I've had put off because of this pandemic coverage and then election coverage. So I'm looking forward to doing that, actually. Some more sort of, longer term things that I can get my teeth into, which I'm really looking forward to. Just getting back into some decent training. And I'm excited. I'm excited.
It did feel like kind of a juncture this weekend, hey? It did feel sort of especially for us, you know, having
a car crash along the way.
Absolutely. And by intimating that Eugene didn't have a psychotic episode
or a car crash
he's saying you got to hang out with me. People generally aren't having the best time because I'm boring, but
whatever.
Patreon patrons,
yes.
So look, we love doing this. We want to get out to more races. I think this weekend showed us that we like being out and about, and we're going to do more of it. And we'd love you to come on board by setting up a regular donation, even for the cost of a cup of coffee a month. Help us do things that are a bit outside our reach, like buying audio equipment to improve our sound quality, perhaps getting a Zoom thing that I couldn't break if I dropped it, getting more races to interview people. It would also help us keep the lights on. So yeah. And if you can't and it's not in your wheelhouse, like, we're so happy you're here.
And if you have, thank you very much.
Thank you, our undying support, and aroha to you.
Right. Stuff you should know. Joining us is the man himself, Malcolm Law. How you doing, Mal?
I'm very well, thanks, guys. Yourselves?
Well, we're a bit excited because you've got a special announcement, a bit of a surprise announcement for us. Spill the beans.
Yeah. So a little something that we've been working on for quite a wee while now, which really it's an idea that was largely born when Sal and I fast-packed the Hard Rock course over in Colorado a couple of years back. And it's such an amazing thing to be part of, because we fast-packed the course, and then immediately after we'd finished, the Hard Rock race began, so we were around for that. And it's just such an amazing course and amazing event. And all I was thinking in the back of my mind the whole time was, we should have something like this in New Zealand. Mm. And we haven't got it. Yet we've got big mountains, and we've got a lot of people who would love to come to New Zealand to run in those mountains. So why haven't we got something like this? And that planted a seed of an idea. And so essentially, we, over the last 2 years, have been looking at a lot of maps, talking to quite a few people, talking to landowners, and we have developed a course that I think rivals Hard Rock.
Wow.
Yeah. So I've, you know, the sort of, as a project in the back of my mind, it's been, the working title is the Hard Rock of the South. It's basically something that is as big a challenge as Hard Rock, albeit in a slightly different way. We haven't got the altitude that Colorado's got, but we've got other things that can make life pretty tricky out here in New Zealand.
Wow.
We've got a true 100 mile mountain journey all mapped out, and we are dead keen to make it an event for Kiwis and for internationals when they can come back into the country.
Yeah.
To take on what is going to be a really humongous but beautiful course.
Wow. That's exciting.
Is this, so you were saying Hard Rock of the South. Do you have a name for this thing?
We do. It is going to be called The Wild.
The Wild.
The Wild.
The Wild.
That's awesome.
Yeah. So
very appropriate.
Yeah, I've obviously got an obsession with the word wild. I mean, that's obvious to anyone, born of my love of wild places. But it truly is a wild course. It goes right into some pretty deep backcountry. There will be 2 points during the 100-mile race where your feet touch tarmac, and that is to cross a road.
Wow.
And they're the only 2 points for 100 miles where your feet will touch tarmac. So
wow.
When I say it's a wild backcountry course, I mean it's a wild backcountry course.
And where's it based?
Right. So details of the course will be gradually revealed over the fullness of time. But we are essentially in the Queenstown, Arrowtown, Wanaka area. There's a lot of big mountains around here. There's a lot of amazing country to send people through, so that's the general area. Yeah.
And you said in an email to us that you'd been cooking it up with, you know, you and Sally, and there were perhaps some other people involved too. So who else have you sort of roped in to plan out this purgatory for people?
Yeah, we've involved a few friends just in as sounding boards to in terms of the course development. So back in the early days, we brought in Matt Bixley to look at a few maps and generate a few ideas. Then good friend Ian Evans, who you will have been witnessing just recently in the backyard, Ultra.
Yep.
Ian got involved, and of course my old mate, my big adventure buddy James Harkham, always has some ideas on where courses could or couldn't go.
Wow.
So between us, we poured over maps quite a lot and came up with a rough idea. And then a year last winter, we did a lot of reccing, just trying to. There's quite a few sort of grey areas on the map where we go, I don't know if we can get through there or not. I don't know if there's permissions for that or not. So it's gradually evolved.
And what time of year are you looking at?
We are looking at doing it in December, but it's going to be 2 years away.
Right.
Wow.
Yeah, so we've got plenty of lead time.
Yeah.
Originally, we were looking at doing it December next year, and then this little thing, I don't know if you've heard of it, COVID came along? Yeah.
Not familiar with it, sorry.
Okay, well, you can look it up online after the conversation is finished.
I'm sorry.
Yeah. So December 2022.
Yeah, that's what we're shooting for.
Wow. Brilliant.
Well, that gives people plenty of time to train for this beast.
Yeah, well, we kind of figured that, you know, it is this kind of thing which you need to get onto people's calendars well in advance.
Absolutely,
yeah, that's true. That's very true.
And we're very keen to bring in some top international names to take part in it.
Yeah.
And right now, no one from overseas is going to put New Zealand on their calendar for December next year.
No.
Probably not going to get here.
Yeah, exactly. And, it's ironic, really, because if you were going to put anywhere in the world on your calendar to come and run, or indeed watch a fully packed rugby game or anything, it would be Aotearoa at the moment, you know?
But
those 2 years will fly by, I imagine, with, you know, getting stuff ready for the race. And so are you doing a pre-order or pre-sales, or is it qualifying based?
There's an awful lot to do between now and then still. So we've got a website just about to go live. When I say a website, it's actually just a landing page at this point in time. So it's nothing other than a few nice pictures from around the course. But there is there a sign-up form so people can register their interest at this early stage. So we're just keen to get the word out there, start getting people talking about it, getting excited about it, and they can – just sign up for updates on that landing page. So that's going to be the wild100.co.nz.
The wild 100. Okay. And
yeah,
Mel, you mentioned obviously it doesn't have the altitude of Hard Rock, but you said it has some other challenges that people will be presented with. Do you want to outline for us some of those? I hope none of them are mountain lions, by the way.
No, we're not going to import those.
Great.
If you just look at the stats, we're very similar to Hard Rock. So it is 100 miles, probably just a little over. And it's all serious mountain country. So we've got probably 10 major climbs around the course, a dozen peaks that you go over. And more climb than Hard Rock. We're, at the moment, you know, based on the mapping we've done, we're reckoning about 11,000 meters of climb over the course.
Wow.
So, you know, you get your hill legs on. But I guess what, I mean, the thing that surprised me about Hard Rock when we fast-packed it, it was every bit as brutal, every bit as beautiful as I expected. But there's not an awful lot of technical terrain on it. You're either on reasonably well-groomed trail or dirt road for a lot of the way.
Yeah.
Just over some of the high passes, it gets a little bit technical. But for the most part, you're following a very defined trail.
Right.
What we've got when you send people into the deep backcountry in this part of the world around, you know, Queenstown, Arrowtown, Wanaka, is you're on to at the very best sort of animal tracks. There's going to be a lot of pretty much off track running. There's two or three long ridge sections where really you've got nothing to follow but the natural geography of the land. So nice challenge for course marking.
Mm.
But in terms of the sheer physicality of the course, I think the terrain we're sending people through is going to kind of make up for a lot of the fact that we're running at a lower altitude than you would be in Colorado.
Right.
Yeah.
So I'm fully expecting that the finishing times are going to be pretty similar to what you see at Hard Rock. So if someone goes under 24 hours, it's going to be someone of absolute world-class caliber, pedigree that does it. Mm. We're working with a 50-hour cutoff for the slowest people.
Wow.
And there'll be a lot of people in the 40 to 50-hour bracket, I think, to get around this thing.
Wow. But serious stuff.
The thing that really excites me, and another thing we've got in common with Hard Rock is that this is a true journey. It's a beautiful, clean, natural loop through the mountains. So you start and finish at the same point. You do a big, sweeping loop, and there's nothing contrived about it at all. There's no loops within loops or out and backs. It's just a beautiful, clean journey through the mountains.
Wow.
So
I can't imagine how many hours.
It makes for a fantastic adventure.
I can't imagine how many hours you had to pore over maps to get just one loop. That's a lot. Wow.
That's the fun bit.
Yeah.
I mean, and we're probably still playing with some of the very finer details of the course.
Yeah.
I'm hoping to give it a crack myself towards the end of this year, just to scope it out. I'll probably do it more fast-packing style than race style. I don't think I'd want to try and attempt it with a 48-hour time limit on me.
Yeah, especially not by yourself.
No. Well, I'll probably have company for at least some of it.
Yeah.
But yeah, we'll know a little bit more about the true nature of it when I've done that, I guess.
It sounds stunning, and I can hear in your voice that just you sound genuinely, genuinely excited.
Oh,
and with that genuine sort of amount of challenge in there as well. So December 2022, which I'm sure will fly by in the blink of an eye, The Wild. And what's the website again?
It's thewild100.co.nz.
Brilliant. Fantastic.
All right, Mal, we better go and get our hill legs on.
Yeah, I'm going to go do some squats now.
Yeah.
One
other thing I'd just like to mention, if I could.
Yes.
In developing this, we've been on again, off again in our minds. Things like COVID came along and really threw us.
Mm.
The original place that we wanted to have as the event base required some extra landowner permissions, and one person refused it, which threw the original plan out. So there's been a lot of toing and froing.
Mm.
Through that and through COVID, we kind of, we have asked ourselves, do we really want to do this? And we came to the realization that, we're the dreamers in this. We're the people with the ambition to create this thing, but we don't really have the experience to put on an event of this nature personally. And there's a lot of background work, all that horrible stuff like concessions and safety plans and traffic management plans that we don't have the skill base for, or to be honest, the desire to do. So we've basically rescued the plan by deciding to bring in some professionals.
Mm-hmm.
So we've got Fusion Events involved.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
The guys behind Ultra NZ Series, so the Valley Ultra and Ultra 24 and the new Coastal Ultra next year.
Mm-hmm.
So they have got the expertise and the professionalism and all the systems and the contacts
and
all those key areas. So it's kind of like, It wouldn't happen without those guys, because we came to the realization that actually
there's a lot to it.
Yeah.
We'd rather be doing the fun stuff like dreaming up the course and helping with the promotion and the marketing.
Yeah.
We don't want to get our hands dirty with all that other stuff. So we are working very closely with them. They're immensely excited about it as well.
Brilliant.
And I think it's going to be a great combination of the dreamers and the doers.
Fantastic.
Brains in the brawn.
Something happen.
Yeah. Brilliant. Yeah. All right. Well, thank you so much for letting us know about it.
Hey, pleasure. And thanks for all the great work you guys are doing.
No, it's a pleasure.
Pressed as always that you keep churning it out week after week. It's incredible.
Well, and thanks for supporting us as well.
Yeah, thanks for supporting us. It's awesome. It's really, really good. Will you be down at Kepler?
Funnily enough, I said I was never going to do another Kepler. So, yes, I'll be there.
Fantastic. We'll see you then.
See you then.
You bet.
All cheers, right. Mel.
Thanks, Mel. Digits Radio.
Kia ora, everyone. This is Eugene here. I've got an update to Mel's announcement. He says, I realised in the excitement of telling you about the 100-mile course, I forgot to mention that we are also planning a 50-mile and 20-mile, which is 80K and 32K courses as well. Both perfect loops through awesome country too. Plenty of wild to them both. So he just asked us to mention that too. Go on, get amongst it.
Wow.
Yeah.
That, I mean, yeah. People are going to be very excited about that.
It makes sense. Like, I've been hanging out a bit with Ian this weekend, especially because he didn't bring up any crew with him. I know he's that. And he was like, oh, I'll just go and crew myself. So Rebecca and I sort of gladly jumped in for a couple of hours there yesterday. And, you know, he's one of the many indefatigable people there and his love of the outdoors and the mountains and Mel's love of the outdoors and the mountains and Sal's love of the outdoors and James and all those people. It's just going to be amazing. And the 2 years, it sounds kind of weird, you know, planning something for 2022, but it's going to fly by, I'm sure.
It will. It will. Absolutely. Right. Heap of races back on this
again,
weekend.
Yeah.
So first of all, the New Zealand Trail Running Champs were in the Port Hills at the Crater Rim Race.
Absolutely. That sounds like a banger.
53K, yeah, was the title race. Nancy Zhang regained the women's title after winning first of all in 2018.
Yeah.
So she clocked a race record.
Wow.
5:43:38, which was faster than Mal Aiken's title win last year. So she beat it by quite a bit margin because it was 5:57 last year was Mel's
yep. Title 24 minutes. Last
year. Yeah. So yeah, Katie Smith was second in 6:25:43, and the aforementioned Mel Aiken, it's a weekend, so she must be racing.
Yeah.
Third in 6:28:04, and Kirsten Foley was fourth in 6:49:42, and Nancy said she felt really good. Despite being hampered in preparation by a tendon tear in her foot in June. Yeah, remember she's been out riding her bike.
Yeah, absolutely. And ski touring. She's been getting amongst it.
She said, I was strong in the climbs and good on the descents. The ski touring must have worked. There was very little wind out there and it was super sunny. I even think coming from Queenstown, it was a little hot. And she said she felt it was a really good feeling to win a national title and she's just stoked to be out there running. We're in a really privileged position here in Aotearoa.
No, we certainly are. And in the men's race, I wasn't torn because they're both really nice people and really amazing. Did you see any of the footage of them running on the weekend? Oh, my Lord. So Weston Hill, winner, he won the Crater Rim in 2017. He returned to claim the New Zealand title in the 53 kilometres around the Port Hills, and he won that in a record time of 4:38:31. Scotty Hawker, you know, he'd normally be overseas this time of year, but he was second, racing real hard after quite a disrupted build-up in 4:47:01, with defending champ Vajan Armstrong third in 4:57:33, and Will Jones, who was third last year, fourth in 5:08:22. Amazing. You know, Westy said, I'm really stoked to pull it off, and there were some fast dudes here and I knew I'd have to get it right on the day if I was to win the race. It looks like he really did. He said, the lads went reasonably fast at the start and were testing each other out. We had a steady climb up Mount Herbert and I power hiked away from the group in an effort to feel whether they would chase me, but nobody did, said Hill.
Wow. Yeah, and it was sort of, there was some updates coming through on Instagram, went there and it was, you could see the time between Scotty and West, and you were sort of wondering, is Scotty going to make a charge? And he certainly did towards the end.
Absolutely.
There, but just didn't have enough time to bite it up, eat
they
it up. So
flying.
Yeah, what a race. And Vajan, I mean, you know, wow. He you know, ran at Abel Tasman last week. He's just relentless, isn't he?
All class.
Yeah.
So other results, in the 30 kilometres, in the men's race, Ryan Carr, 2:24 flat, Steve Melton, 2:34:59, and Hayden Zervos, 2:35:09.
The women, Maggie Bichard, 3:06:20, Sarah Munro, 3:07:11, and Catherine Wilson, 3:15:16.
The 22-kilometre, Richard Melton, 1:45:35, Buddy Small, 1:52:22, and Edward Cromwell, 1:58:34.
And the women, Louise Darwin, 2:05:12, Savannah Stewart, 2:07:53, and Fiona Gilroy, 2:13:27.
In the 10 kilometres, Kevin Grimwood took it home in 46:46, Matt Dawson, 49:54, and Lee Butts, 51:09.
And the women, Sarah Bryant, 56:39, Holly Weston, 101.31 and Alice Walsh 102.44.
Amazing effort, everyone. It looked like a stunning day.
Stunning day. Right, so the Wild Auckland series was got underway at Mahurangi, which is northeast of Auckland. The course this year was they managed to get access to some parklands which haven't been
never
able to be used before.
Yep, absolutely.
So amazing. Yeah, amazing.
How the Collinses do it every year is beyond me. And when Madeline and the girls came back to support Sean, they were absolutely fizzing, and everyone who'd run came, sort of there was a little convoy that came back, and everyone was just pumped. So in the expedition, which is the long course, about 24k, first female was Mari Manja in 2:23 flat. Second was Petrina Kerr in 2:31.56, and third Lynn Stanton 2:45.57.
And in the men, Teddy Eister 1:52.50, Tom Hunt, there you go, 1:53.15, and Johan Kvasnivik.
Kvasnicker,
sorry about that, Jan.
201.33. In the mid-course, the Discovery, first female, Amelia Edwards in 1:29.26, Yasmin Campbell 1:31.32, and Joe Burke in 1:40.39.
And in the men,
Gilliam. Yeah.
Leonard. 1:15.50, Damon Nicholas 1:17.40, and Daniel Matheson 1:21.11, and that's a 16k course.
Yep. In the tour, which is the 10k, Annie Rose Collins killing it in 1 hour and 58 seconds. Zara Collins, there's a bit of a beat up going on here, in 1:03.38, and third was Michelle Dean in 1:03.12.
Good on ya. And in the men's, Daniel 49:25, Declan Moore 56:07. Is that just somebody's put their name in twice, or
yeah?
And James Mann 56:39. And the PR event is coming up on November 15.
It's going to be amazing.
Yes.
So Exterior Wellington, the Woolshed run at Belmont National Park, Regional Park was on. They had a long course of 18 kilometres, and first woman there was Miranda Lintott in 1 hour and 43 seconds, then Carla Dennehy in 1 hour 45.05. It's quite a winning margin.
Yeah.
And Heather Walker in 1:51 flat.
And the men's, Andrew Rowe 101.12, Chris Lyons 1:23.49, and Stuart Milne 1:25.15.
In the medium course, it was Laura Green taking it home in 1:04.54, Rosie Walsh in 1:12.31, and Sal Lennon in 1:13.34.
And in the men's medium course, which is about 12k, Stephen Woodwork 1:07.13, Denny Adamson 1:09.12, and Tobias Work 1:09.31. Oh, a bit of a tight finish there.
Chuck a blanket over them. In the short course, Sasha Kilmister took it home in 34 minutes and 41 seconds. Cheryl Moyer in 35:29 and Jessica Young in 35:52.
And in the men's, Dan Hunt 24:28. Jacob Kilmister.
Yeah.
Yeah, there you go. 28:02 and Simon Derbyshire 30 minutes and 31 seconds.
So good to be reading out results.
Yes. Yes.
Which brings us to greatest run ever, which is the part.
I'm just going to do that. Over the top of you. I'm going to do it again as well, like that. Yeah.
Greatest run ever.
Greatest run ever, which is the part of the show where we ask you to write into us and tell us your greatest run ever. It doesn't have to be a race or a mountain summit. It might just be that time that you ran home from Eugene's house in tears because he embarrassed you on a podcast. It might just be a run around the block, something that sung to you for some reason. Send it into us at churchradio@gmail.com. This is from Maury Abraham.
Maury.
Principal Maury. Mr. Abraham.
Yes.
Yep.
We're standing up.
That's right.
Yep.
Okay, kia ora. I have a new greatest run ever, which I don't think will ever be replaced. Myself and several of my family members committed to the Rotorua Marathon, various distances with my mum set for the 6K, another set for the half, to honour my dad, Bunny Abraham, who passed away last November. He was a member of the Rotorua Marathon Survivors Club. And now what is that, Eugene?
So it's if you've done 15 marathon Rotoruas.
Sick, that's no small feat. Mm. And inspired and mentored me to discover a passion for running and racing during my teenage years and into later life. We were all primed for May, but then faced the setback as the race was postponed until September. However, we set ourselves for September, and in the meantime, I signed up to fundraise for mental health, and I went to the Mental Health Foundation of New Zealand. So we were dealt another blow when Aucklanders were banned from competing in September, and he puts a decision which he totally understands. The rest of the family decided if we couldn't all be there, then we would postpone our combined effort until 2021. I was aware that I'd raised a substantial amount of money for mental health and felt a responsibility to those who had sponsored, so decided to travel to Rotorua, wear a mask and socially distance and cheer my brother on, who decided to complete the half marathon despite being a smoker and not having done one run in preparation.
Whoa.
If you're going to go, go big, yeah. Like, I was so proud of him completing the event in just over 3 hours, and he's talking about returning next year. I woke up on Sunday morning to discover the weather bomb had parked itself over Rotorua, but set off at the official start time, although 24 hours late, and started my solo plot around the lake. It persisted down for all but the last 4K and a short 2K bit in the middle. While I felt strong, my legs were sore from the first step as a result of some minor injury from decades of imbalance in my running. My old man came into my thoughts early in the run, but I had to banish him as I knew later on I'd really need his inspiration. And that proved to be true as the heavens opened in the long haul from the airport. I now welcomed him into my thoughts during the lonely haul, and I'm sure it was his presence, which resulted in me finishing with reverse splits. When I crossed the official finish line with only my wife there to scoop me up, I was overwhelmed with emotion in a way that truly caught me by surprise. I believe that somehow my dad wanted to make it as tough as possible. What I do know is that he is directly responsible for me rediscovering my passion for running, and I'm looking forward to him inspiring me to complete the Auckland Marathon, one he and I competed in and finished together 25 years ago, the Spates West Coast Marathon, and my ultimate tribute to him, the Tarawera 102km in February. I'll never forget that lonely slog around the lake. Ngā mihi, Māori.
Ka pai e ho. Yeah, oh my goodness. That's amazing, Maury. And I saw Maury's updates on Facebook and stuff. So I did have a little sneak preview, I guess, of this greatest run ever. And I also saw Maury training around the roads around here. He was out rain, hail, snow.
Yeah.
It's no snow, but he was out along Cardi Road running around in training. So well done, Maury. You, sir, are an inspiration too. Now, if the rest of you want to not get in trouble with us, send us in your greatest runs ever.
Do it.
Right, on to our show, and all I'm going to say is, take it away, bro.
Digits Radio.
Kia ora whanau, it's Matt here. It's 10:30 on Saturday, October the 17th, and it's the night of New Zealand's general election, and I'm going on an adventure. I wish Eugene were here with us, but he's been working super hard over the last couple of months covering the election, and tonight being the election, he's working, so gutted, but you know, thanks for all your hard work, bro. Love what you do. But I'm not going by myself. I've got some pretty awesome company. I've got Rebecca Short, my brilliant wife, and the Riverhead Relapse Backyard Ultramarathon race director, and Cora Glenn Rigby, if we're using his full name, four-year-old red and tan Australian Kelpie, such a good boy, and third son of Baz and Bindi. Tonight's special not just for the historic election result, it's also hours away from the worldwide start of Big's Backyard Ultramarathon in Tennessee, and Australia, and Canada, and the UAE, and Ireland, and Germany, and Russia, and Ukraine, Hong Kong, Japan, Switzerland, Finland, France, Singapore, Philippines, Israel, Spain, Denmark, Mexico, Norway, Sweden, and little old Aotearoa, New Zealand. As we know, Biggs was cancelled this year, along with most other races around the world, thanks to COVID. And thanks to Fast Dave, some very hardworking Canadians, and Zoom existing, now we've got a real international ding-dong on our hands. For those of you who don't know how a backyard ultramarathon works, it's like this. It's a mass start on the hour, and the participants have to complete a loop of 6.7 kilometers within that hour, and then on the next hour it starts again, and again, and again. And if you can't complete the lap in the hour, or you fail to start on the whistle on the next hour, you're out, until there's literally the last person standing. The teams will be representing each of their countries and working to become the champion of their respective countries' races and working to become the champion overall. How it works globally is that you need two competitors completing laps on the hour to win. And globally, there's a huge amount of talent taking part. I mean, I won't even get into how incredible it's looking, but, you know, for instance, Maggie Gutierrez in the US, she's saying she wants to go over 100 laps. But look, we've got some pretty amazing talent on our team. Matt Bailey, Chris Bisley, Sean Collins, Ian Evans, Mike Field, Fiona Hayvice, Adam Keane, Glenn Kelly, Andrew McDowell, Michael Stewart, Russ Thomas, Andy Smith, Glenn Sutton, Damian Wood, and last but not least, Dr. Katie Wright. She was the winner of last year's Riverhead Relapse and the first woman in the world to win a backyard event, and fourth at last year's Biggs, and the person to hold the record for most times on Dirt Church Radio. So, yeah, look out, world. We're coming at you. And about Riverhead Relapse and the reasons for our adventure tonight. Like, first off, the Virtual Bigs is taking place in our backyard, Riverhead. We had the privilege of working with Madeline and Sean at Lactic Turkey last year on the inaugural relapse, only to have COVID ruin our plans not once, but heartbreakingly short notice twice. So we're stoked to get the chance to run from home. The start's about an hour away from our house at a leisurely pace, looking up at the stars and enjoying the trails. The three of us are going to cruise over, witness the start, see so many of our dear friends, and have a grand old time. It's incredible the talent and stamina, both mental and physical, that the athletes undertaking Bigs have. I went for my long run today, and I've got my fingers up doing air quotes. It was around 30 kilometres, and for most people, you know, that's a reasonable run. And I marvelled that there will be so many people doing 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 times that amount over the, you know, the coming days. I ran down through some of the trails and the course that the New Zealand Backyard Ultra will be taking place, and Barlow Road was hot. The valley is like a crucible. It gets really, really hot, and the start is going to be really, really cold because there's no clouds currently and it's very, very still. So I'm really looking forward to seeing how things play out. But that's enough talking for now. Time for an adventure.
Dirt Radio.
Okay, so we've been travelling for about 40 minutes and we're at the highest point of the Riverhead Forest, and so I'm with Rebecca. What are we seeing? What are we looking at?
Ah, the Sky Tower.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
And the whole of Auckland City. We thought we'd be the only ones up here, but there are a couple of dudes on a quad bike who roared off. That's where our light's coming over the hill. Obviously don't want to be disturbed, but it's amazing. We're standing at the highest point of the forest. There's a starry sky, and the city below is beautiful, and we've got our, I know it's not exactly podcast material, but we've got our headlamp lamps off, and it is just the most incredible sight. So the only way to go now is down, and we're going to jog down to the start of the Bigs. Fantastic. What you're looking at is a Zoom. Well, what I'm standing in front of is the surreal thing of a computer monitor with a Zoom screen. Here we go, listen. This is
great. As you can tell, everyone is in the same position. Lots of excitement has happened. Last minute logistics, all the things that need to happen are happening. Just to reiterate the program schedule, we, at the top of the hour, the bell will go. We will get to see all the runners being released by the clock to head out on their courses.
There's a clock and it's counting down. It's 18 minutes and 45 seconds. So we're at the bottom of Arimu Valley Road at the motorbike sheds, and it's a little hive of activity. There's tents, there's camper vans, there's everything, and it's quite a scene. All right, state your name for the record, sir.
Russ Thomas.
Well, congratulations on getting on the New Zealand Bigs team. How are you feeling, man?
Yeah, thank you. I'm feeling really grateful, appreciative that I'm here. I've been training all year for the NZ one, cancelled, then bang, we're here.
Yeah.
But in great physical shape. And then I just text my sister back in Wales, here we go, which is normally a woof, up we go, here we go, ready to go slow.
Yeah.
So I think this time around I'm just going to chill and just go long. Yeah, can't wait. But looking forward to having fun with everyone. And my name, I must admit, is I know some of the Americans are looking at the personal stuff. I'm just like, how well can we go with Team NZ? That's the bit, right? I'm excited about. I'm watching that Google sheet and seeing us go up the rankings. That's what's going to fire me up.
Wicked. Yeah. So it's interesting, isn't it? There's a collective goal and there's an individual goal as well.
Yeah. Well, and you know, I don't know anyone else in any other country, but obviously the caliber of runners in this NZ team, you can just see resilience across everyone's face, you know.
Absolutely.
So I really do think we're going to go really well. I'm excited. So I just want to make sure I don't let the team down. So on paper, I'm possibly the weakest, but on form. But on form, I've been training really well.
You've been training your butt off.
Yeah. But I think I've come with the right attitude this time to enjoy it, relax, and looking forward to it.
All right, I'll let you get some more space, brother.
Thank you.
Well done. Thanks, and we're going to come back tomorrow anyway. But I'm proud of you, bro. And
thank you.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Kill it.
There we go. Thank you.
All right, state your name for the record, sir.
My name is Sean the Running Beast Collins.
I can't believe that we're finally here. Well, I can't believe that. I mean, I'm finally here because I decided to go on a date night run with my missus. But, like, you're here. Third time lucky.
Yeah, I know. It's pretty exciting to be actually able to do a loop.
Yeah.
Under the time conditions.
Absolutely. With other people. Yeah. And we're standing here and it's nearly 1 in the morning. It's 10 to 1 in the morning. So it's less than 10 to 1 in the morning. And you guys are about to head off on the night laps.
Yeah, it's real cool. It's been a long wait.
Yeah.
Setting up yesterday slowly and everybody arriving and setting up the tents and bands and stuff.
Yeah.
And then we're like, oh, what now? Can't we just start?
How's your recovery been after your circumnavigation of Auckland?
The recovery is a bit slow.
Yeah.
But I came right, but then I pulled my back 3 weeks ago.
Oh.
It's pretty bad, but pushing through it.
Yeah.
Had some good physio the last couple of weeks. It's just going to be a constant reminder to me to keep moving. It's good when I'm moving.
And do you have I spoke to Russ before, and he was talking about the fact that he wanted to, he was more sort of into it for the collective.
Yeah, no.
And versus the personal. I mean, how are you? What are your thoughts?
Yeah,
on that?
Definitely, it's going to be an awesome thing doing it as a team.
Yeah,
and making sure that everyone's like communicating when they're in their down patches, so we can all help bring them back up and that.
Yeah,
yeah. I really want to be like positive and make sure that people are feeding off that, so that we can all go together long.
Have you had a team talk?
Yeah. Oh, we haven't had a talk as such. I was going to do one now. We had a bit of a briefing earlier on, just went through the rules because some people are new to it. Like more than half of them are new to it, which is cool.
Yeah.
To do a last person standing for the first time.
So cool.
Yeah.
There's some keyed up looking people.
Oh, yeah.
Focused looking people.
Yeah, it's good.
Yeah. Man, all right. Well, look, we're going to pop back tomorrow morning and, well, we'll be here for hours anyway, just hanging out. But like,
I will be here. You'll find us.
Yeah. Damn right. All right. Well, we'll stick around for the briefing.
Yeah, thanks for coming over. Oh,
it's our absolute pleasure. We ran over and it was just the perfect. We felt it would actually be, in a funny way, a real way to kind of honour the event. Drive up. But, and we wouldn't have missed it for the world because we've had two. You know, this has been denied to us twice as well. So, yeah.
Cool.
All right, man. Well,
okay.
I'm so privileged and proud to be here, and go well.
It's going to be awesome.
Cheers, brother.
Let's do it.
So Sean's just about to give the team briefing. It's 5 minutes to go, and we're going to get in.
Hello.
Hey, Katie. Right. How are you doing?
You have a bit of an adventure.
Yeah.
Adventure evening.
Absolutely. I'm recording. You mind if I grab it?
Why not?
So I'm with Katie Wright. How are you feeling?
Yeah, good. Excited that we're actually here. I haven't really let myself get that excited.
No.
Because I'm like, something's going to happen. Yeah, something's going to happen.
But, you're being
gotta go.
Summoned by the beast. Oh, so nice to see you.
We'll see you.
All right. We'll see you off. Yeah.
A couple of things from yesterday. One of the early evenings briefing, because a couple of people weren't here. But the important things are that we're doing the night loop we switch over at 8 o'clock.
We are less than 4 minutes. Four minutes.
You're running
from the start.
To the end of
the start of the night loop.
That's the 3 minute whistle.
On the first lap, if you get there, there won't be anything. The longer that we all go out there, the better it's going to be for the team result, but also for the
some very, very, very keyed up, fit looking people here with amazing amounts of intent on their faces. They're all just stripping off their gears and lining up. Matt,
hey, how you doing?
Good
to see you.
Yeah, good to see you too. Nice to meet you.
Awesome. Awesome.
Well done, brother. And
getting into it.
Yeah, yeah.
You're here at a good time.
We ran over from home, so.
Oh, nice.
Yeah.
I wonder how close you guys were.
Yeah.
So we've been camped up here for a day, so.
Nice one.
Oh, is this Rigby?
Yeah, this is Rigby, and this is my wife, Rebecca. This is Chris.
Hi, how are you? Hey.
Oh.
You guys do it.
Get.
This is outstanding.
Andrew McDowell.
Right. Let's
go,
well, brother.
Go on, you, mate.
Go well, guys.
Very, very excited looking people. Right around the world. That's incredible.
Get it done. Woo-hoo-hoo-hoo!
And so they're off on the first of their first of the night loops. And it's an incredible thing because Sean and Russ, they talked about that sense of the collective, you know, and it's a team event, it's an individual event, and the rub with that, but I'm super excited to see how this plays out.
So much fun. I can't wait.
I'm here with race photographer extraordinaire and all-round good bastard, Canal. How are you, brother?
Yeah, doing all right, doing all right. Yourself?
Yeah, good, good. Are you here for have you got a tent or your car? Or?
A car?
Yeah.
I'm just sort of driving back and forth from home. Yeah.
Nice one.
Yeah.
It's quite a bit of a different start from last time, isn't
it? It is. It's very different. It's very different. But still a pretty good turnout and atmosphere here. So, yeah.
Oh,
no.
Amazing.
No.
All right. Well, I mean, are you going to be, I guess, based around here for the next couple of hours and then make your way out onto the course?
Or? Yeah, I think I'm going to do maybe a little bit out on the course and then maybe go back home, sleep, and then come back for sunrise.
So I think we're not going to be back for sunrise. We'll probably be home by sunrise, but like we're going to run home soon. Well, give it a bit. And they won't be very long, I don't think, because it's a night loop. It's the first one. They'll be keyed up. So.
Yeah, exactly. So,
fresh, yeah.
No, it should be good. Was there marking it this morning, so.
Fantastic.
It's looking good. So.
Is it nice and dry through there?
There's a couple of little muddy patches, but.
Yeah. Not too bad.
It's not too bad.
That's good. It's going to get. I ran through here this today, and it was so hot because it was completely still, and there was no cloud, and there was no wind, and it was stinking hot, and it's going to get really freezing cold.
Yes,
I can't.
It's going to be extreme. Say the temperatures are going to be.
Yeah. Oh man, I'm sure we're going to do it. So stoked! All right, brother, we'll catch up. It's 1:44 in the morning, and I'm just seeing the first 7 lights coming through the village on the team returning from their first night loop. You can see Andrew McDowell. Someone's way off the front. I wonder if that's Russell. But yeah, it's pretty exciting. I can see Matt Bailey. And yeah, everyone is remarkably well, like, hanging out together. Some people are walking through, some people are running through. It is beautiful conditions here, but it's very, very cold. And all of a sudden, the little village has sprung into life. Everyone's been sitting around. Some people have been, you know, perhaps drinking a beer and hanging out, and everyone is getting amongst it now, getting their stations ready for the runners, and they'll be into the corral and then off again the next 15 minutes. It's pretty exciting.
It's just about to go for the second lap. Everyone's been really relaxed. Some people are hanging out in the shed. Some people are going back to their corrals. Not, I don't think many people are eating. Everyone just looks totally focused and, yeah.
3 minutes. There we go, 3 minutes to go. I'm standing next to Gareth Morris, who's videoing. It looks very fancy, the setup you got there, man.
All again, no idea, buddy.
You tell me about it. When I took this, Eugene was, I was like, can I get the DCR Zoom recorder? He was like, okay. I think he knows. He's like, don't get it wet. I won't.
Covered in mud, bits hanging off.
I was so paranoid. It's a surreal experience. This whole thing is so surreal. It's a word I keep using, but
it's one of the reasons why I've come here to see this experience, because there's no way in hell I'm running one of these things. So I thought it'd be cool just to come and watch and experience what it's going to be like for the next couple of days.
Absolutely. Are you camping out?
Yeah, I'm camping out. I've got a place. So I'm going to nip home a little bit because I'm not too far away.
Yeah.
Half an hour's drive.
Yeah.
But yeah, just... Yeah, the next time they... Next Bigs, hopefully, will be back in Bellbuckle, Tennessee, so they might not have it in the same way.
Yeah.
So... You know, we've got this opportunity to come and see this and and see it all go off, you know.
Yeah, absolutely. So everyone's in the corral and ready to go for the second time. 15 on the board to New Zealand.
We've still got 15. We've got 14. Tell me we've got 14. 14.
53 seconds and we're off. Hey Matt, how are you?
Good, mate.
Good to see you, man.
Yeah, and
you look well.
Yeah, not too bad. Like one.
Yeah. You go. All right, you go well. Get it done. See ya. Just like that, everyone's off for lap number two of what will be God knows how many, and we are going to run home now because it is freezing cold and very, very early in the morning. So. One experience.
Hey, I just want to clarify something. I did not scold you for taking the Zoom recorder, and if I sighed, that's just the way I breathe.
Look, that was more a function of my inbuilt anxiety as it relates to breaking our shiny Zoom recorder, which I've
thanks,
never
Patreon
really...
Thanks, Patreon patrons.
Yeah, thanks, Patreon patrons. And I was projecting, you know, if you think of it in like an American Beauty type thing, I am but a plastic bag buffeted on the winds of counter-transference and artistic license. And I humbly and unreservedly apologise.
No need to, but, you know, I just don't want people thinking that I'm mean. There's a line in a Katy Perry song where she says, "Do you ever feel like a plastic bag?" Which I've always thought is the dumbest lyric I've ever heard. But I think you've just said sometimes you do.
Yep.
I take it back, Katy. I humbly and unreservedly apologise to Katy Perry. Anyway, you and Rebecca, you headed off home and then you came back late on Sunday morning.
So we're back at the Bigs. It's 10 to 12 in the morning, and we've lost one Kelpie and gained two daughters, and we're just watching everyone come in for their at the end of their 10th lap. So all the competitors have done 67 kilometers at the moment, and everyone's looking strong. There's been no dropouts in the Kiwi team yet, and yeah, really, really exciting. It's still, there's a bit of cloud cover. It's really, really pleasant, but it's going to be getting hot, and Eugene's just arrived. In his, looks like he's ready to do some laps. He's in some athletic gear, and yeah, there's Katy Wright. Hey, Katy, how you doing?
Good. Good to see you.
Good to see you too. Hey, man, I'm Matt.
G'day, Matt. Mike Field. How are you?
Nice to meet you, Mike. And strolling in the end of his 10th lap is the running beast, Sean Collins. How you doing?
Yeah, good.
Yeah.
Yeah, feeling good.
Everyone's still sticking in there. That's awesome.
Yeah. There's a few elastic bands going on legs and things, but we won't read anything into that.
No.
Could be cycling out.
Yeah, it's just sand, the ultimate sandbagging. You should put your neck brace. Yeah.
Brace on so we could all see it.
You should get your neck brace on next lap. Yeah. Or borrow Harry's crutch.
A moon boot.
That's right. Get his moon boot on. So I am. Hi, Eugene.
Hi, man.
How you feeling?
Yeah, good. I'm excited. It's about to head off. They're about to head off on the midday loop.
So they're going out on their 11th loop.
So is everyone still in?
Everyone is still in, man.
Yeah.
Everyone's looking strong.
Fiona Haveice over there looking very chill.
Yep.
Chris Bisley looking chill.
Yeah, he had his feet on my chili bin. I feel so...
Oh, that's awesome.
And Andrew McDowell looking good. Everyone's just looking... Ian Evans is wearing a Hawaiian shirt and just...
Wow, rocking
really
it.
Really relaxing.
Rocking
Adam
it.
Adam Keane's in control. Everyone just looks... Super. I mean, you think about the talent in this group. It's like sound so flossy. It's like a masterclass in kind of like resilience and problem solving and capability.
Yeah. Well, there's the beast, the running beast.
He's eating some sort of wrap.
Probably yeah. got kittens in it.
Yeah, what, exactly.
Two minute whistle.
2 minute whistle.
It's hot, eh?
Yeah, it's warm. It's not as hot as I thought it was going to be. I think a little bit of cloud cover is helping here, which is good. A little bit of a breeze. Sean Collins!
Sean Collins, what's in your wrap?
Chicken, avocado and spinach.
Look at there.
Are you going to be gagging down a whole bag of spinach like you did in The Revenant?
I have got a couple of bags of spinach.
Yeah.
Later on.
Nice.
And things get serious.
You need your Popeye just, forearms.
We're just fucking around at the moment.
Yeah.
We're just here for the lols.
We're still warming up.
Yeah. So yeah, everyone just looks super focused and super good. Like you said before, you can see there's a couple of stiff muscles starting to get in. People are starting, you know, it's, what, 1 minute?
1 minute.
You go on the bow.
And so how do we find out about the, what's happening, at, like how does the international component of this work?
Well, they're all on the Zooms and they've got a leaderboard.
Right.
And now the runners are heading out on the 12th yard or 12th lap.
Monster from the deep south.
Which personally isn't what?
Monster from the deep south.
Wind is actually getting up a little bit.
Yeah, that's good. It'll help cool them down. It'll be nice and radiating.
But it's not good for recording.
No, it's not good for recording. Actually, guys,
can we just get a bit more shelter here, please?
Can we go back? He's, look at him. He's just so cheerful, consistent. Murdering it.
And he ran 52k last weekend.
Yeah, and won that race. Yeah. But Ian, this is his strategy. This was his strategy through last relapse. He's eating, he's cooling down, so he doesn't have to waste energy eating. Get it Woo! Done.
Good.
Come and show the Northerners how it's done. Look, he's walking, he's eating. His time splits over the last relapse until he got sick was 10 seconds over 100 miles from fastest as well. He is...
So he's walking in, he's got a bag.
Yeah, he's eating stroofwafels.
He's got this relaxed look. He looks like he's on a Hawaiian adventure. That's the way to do it, isn't it?
It's the way to do it.
Well,
man.
That's his way of doing it. Everyone has their own way.
I would be a... Someone said to me, Becky Nixon said to me last night, Matt, you going to do it next year? I was like, are you high? I am not. As Tom said, these people are built different. Sonny always goes, I'm built different, Dad, I'm built different. And he says it's somewhat ironically, but I think these people actually are built different.
How about the mental gymnastics you have to go through to go back and forth, back and forth, back and forth? You're so close to the end, yet you still have to go wind your way through.
Well, and actually, what you have to do is you have to come that way and then go out around another loop,
which is
incredible. Here he is.
It's a really, really good
strategy.
Here's Ian Evans.
He's looking good.
Oh, he's looking fantastic. Consistent. What do you got there?
Oh, you got your baby food.
Yeah, 6 months plus, I just make it.
Nice. Oh, they're all coming in now, aren't they?
Yeah.
So what's that?
So we've got Matt Bailey, we've got Andrew McDowell, Sean Collins. And you'll see Sean's got a bit of a run on. He started really conservatively and smartly, and you see this.
I guess you have a different strategy for each lap, don't you, depending on how you're feeling, what you need to do, what you need to get done. So some laps you want to get back a bit faster so you get a bit more time to get in a sleep or whatever.
You don't want to do what that guy in the purple with the mullet did though and bust out a 45 minute lap when you're at like 190k. That didn't go so well for him, but apart from that.
And here comes the beast himself.
Speaking of consistent, well there's so many, isn't there?
Yeah, well that's true, but Andrew McDowell, look at him. Just picture of fitness.
Great to be here.
I bought my recorder.
Looking good,
Matty.
Good, Sean. Woo. Nice. Matt.
Look at this.
Thanks.
Hey.
Well done, guys. All right. That's 12 hours down.
Amazing.
Kate, what are you up to?
Oh, I'm busy scrubbing the pot.
so that we've got it ready for the next round. We had some beautiful lentil bake, but unfortunately it just caught on the bottom, so we're getting into that.
And that's the thing, isn't it? Is that while the runners are out there, there's a big job to be done back at home base.
Absolutely, yeah. Just keeping everything in order and trying to find order in amongst the chaos again. So it's always the way they ask for the one thing that you haven't got ready, so then you chuck everything out of the bin to try and find that one thing, and then it's like, okay, shit, now have we got to get everything back to where it was. So yeah, it's good, but learning so much, it's amazing. Yeah.
And so you're crewing primarily for Fiona?
Yes, for Fee Haveice, along with Todd, her husband. So it's, we've got the luxury of two of us here. Most athletes have only got one person. So, but it's such a nice sort of communal feel this time around. So I think people really helping each other out. And I know, you know, inevitably athletes will start to drop and crew will just step in for other people. So, yeah, it's a lovely, lovely space to be in actually at the moment.
And what do you feel... pressure, or, you know, obviously they've got a job to do, but you've got a job to do as well?
Yeah, definitely. When when you kind of realize that you've mucked up the gap, it's like but they're at the moment, they're still quite coherent about, you know, they're communicating easily what they want, even if it's changing from their plan. I think what will be challenging is in another 24-36 hours, when they're less able to articulate what they're feeling, what's hurting, what they might need, and we're going to have to, it'll be a lot more guesswork, and actually I think that will be more pressure for us, because it's like, if you guess wrong, that could have a, you know, serious effect on someone. You know, it's, you knock their sodium levels out of balance, or don't give them the right carb level or whatever that they need. So yeah, it will change in time for sure.
And are you in for the long haul?
Yes, here for the duration. I'm going to lift back with Fee, so I can't actually go anywhere until she's ready to go. So that seemed quite easy, really, didn't it? Yeah. And it's such a privilege to be here. It's an amazing sort of offer to have the opportunity to crew, because it is an incredible learning sort of space to be in. So, yeah.
And how scientific does it get? I mean, you talked about sodium levels, carb levels. Are you having to keep track of all that stuff and make sure that she's getting the right intake and getting the right sodium and making sure she doesn't dehydrate and things like that?
Yeah, I think each athlete kind of approaches that in a slightly different way. So some are more scientific than others. I think Fee's got quite a scientific approach to her nutrition and hydration normally anyway, and probably because this is her first time at this format, she's tried to, you know, come up with quite a strong plan for us to follow. We are adjusting that as it goes along, obviously, as her needs change. But the other thing is, yeah, so we've got a carbohydrate target, a sodium target, a fibre target. And those can be, low or high at different times. And also when you're introducing caffeine is, you know, quite important. So for different runners, you know, depending on whether they're, what their usual caffeine intake is, then that might sort of affect how they approach that. So, so we're keeping a lot of records as well. So it's not just, what we're expecting to give her, but then what do we actually give her? And even down to things like, you know, reminding to, you know, just schedule toothbrushing and, you know, just get that taste of, you know, the inevitable sort of taste of whatever you're taking out on the trail that you get sick of, sunblock, you know, and then of course there's the whole night to day change and the temperature adjustments, and that's a bit of a lucky dip. You know, they need to go out almost and do a lap and figure out what they need. Yeah.
All right, well, they're coming back in for their 12th, the end of their 12th lap, so I better let you get back to your duties.
Yeah, got to scrub the spot. It's not going to scrub itself.
So here they come.
Where are we, Eugene?
Well, we're about 2.3 kilometres into the loop. We've run out. Here we go. We've got Ian waving at us. Who have we got there?
We've got Ian, Chris Bisley. I can't tell.
Yeah, but they're marching. They're walking up the hill. So they're taking a strategy of walking up this hill. Because you don't want to waste all your energy. It is still. It's getting warm, isn't it? I mean, yeah, you can hear from the. Hear from the terrible audio that there is a bit of wind. The cloud cover's burning off. So who have we got? Andrew McDowell's in there. So what are we? This is the 13th lap, isn't it? 13th lap. It's hot.
He's got his Hawaiian shirt on. He looks like he's going to Tenerife.
He does look like he's going to Tenerife on holiday. Where's the recorder? We forgot the recorder. Oh, we have to run back now. Damn it.
muscles, the muscles on Andrew McDowell. Those biceps. He's got the guns out.
The running beast.
Oh, that was very good. That was very good. That blew out the levels. Yeah. Now we've got a bit of a pack, so that's interesting, isn't it? People sort of go together, march together. Hannah Havice at the front of that little pack. Russ is in there. Katie Wright's in there. Adam Keane's in there. Oh, yeah. No, yeah.
What's going on?
Yeah. Take a seat. Day loop.
This is the day loop, yeah. So it's we're approximately 4 kilometres into the course. The first 2.5K are very exposed and it's very warm. And now we're in some beautiful sort of undulating bush, single track, nice net downhill and really lovely, like the conditions, the ground is tacky underfoot, but it's just perfect. It's peak riverhead. It's not too, it hasn't dried out. It's not too concretey and it's not sloppy. So it's just, it's a beautiful course, but again, it'll be very difficult. I can't imagine doing this. You know, they're on their 13th loop now.
13th loop. So that section where you do go on the road and you are very exposed and it's right in the middle of the day right now, it's very hot. And you've got quite a climb to go from once you emerge from that bit of trail, and then you've got,
it's about a mile?
About a mile, yeah. Of climbing up a gravel road. But most of them adopted a walk strategy. They were walking up there, doing it sensibly. It's interesting to see. Everyone's basically sticking together still, aren't they?
Yeah, absolutely. And we're at the point, and I don't want to make any judgmental calls on this, but we're at the point where there's 14 are in the loop and there's one competitor who was behind us. So he hasn't come through yet. But I'm sure that's a strategic thing. But, even that, we're looking at, they're over 80K now. So huge effort. And starting at 1 o'clock in the morning, I mean, that must have been very difficult.
Yeah, so what, do you sleep during the day while you're waiting? Do you, try and rest? It's quite hard, isn't it? But let's press on and finish this loop and see what the rest of this course is like.
Excellent. All right, so state your name for the record.
Ian Gilmore.
Yeah. And what are you doing here, Ian?
Helping out with the timing here at the New Zealand version of Biggs, and just had a bit of an issue with the satellite and the Wi-Fi.
What happened?
So it seems like the router crapped out, and so had to get that replaced.
So does that mean you lost the Zoom feed, or did you lose the timer? Or
yes, we lost the Zoom feed. The timer wasn't in sync. We couldn't update our lap times into the central repository. So. We were out trying to, with the phones in the air in Riverhead Forest, trying to get some signal. But luckily, our satellite guy came through with another router in about 40 minutes.
Okay.
So we got it back up and running.
Wow.
Which is great.
And I guess there's it goes without saying, there's an added level of complexity. It's hard enough doing a timing and stuff when it's just one race. I mean, how's it being managed worldwide?
So I think there's a kind of a central group looking after the timing. They've created a spreadsheet for each country.
Yeah.
That each country keeps updated. It feeds into a central spreadsheet that looks at how each country is doing and compares, and is kind of a live feed between each of the individual spreadsheets. So I'm not sure who exactly puts that together, but one of Laz's friends, I guess.
yeah, one of them would be a tech savvy, or maybe it's one of the Canadians. But I mean, and how's the Zoom? I mean, if you've been in a place of employment in this year, you've know what Zoom is, but like,
yeah, definitely.
How's that working? How's that?
It's been working surprisingly well. I actually took part in the quarantine backyard,
okay,
which was the first one that the Canadians put on, and it's working a lot better than that. Like the the whistles are coming through clearly, and you know, when we've actually had internet, it's been working fine.
Yeah.
And you get the cowbell from Laz and stuff. So it's
So is Laz? Well. So Laz is in Belt Buckle, Tennessee. He's at home. He's got the Americans there.
Yep.
And everyone else is in their satellite place.
Yep.
And then so he's ringing the belt buckle. He's ringing the cowbell, and everyone's going off.
I think so.
Yeah. So I guess it'd be with timings and stuff, you'd see them fluctuate quite a bit, because the Americans and the people in the Northern Hemisphere, they're on their night loops now.
Yep. Yep. So we started it at 1 a.m.
Yep.
It was, I think, 8 o'clock or 7 o'clock or something in Tennessee.
Yeah.
You know.
Is what it is.
Yeah. Just rolling through. I don't think it gives any team an advantage because...
Well, they're not on daylight savings anymore, are they? Or are they still on daylight savings though?
Don't know.
Yeah. Don't know. We'll have to check the minutiae of worldwide Zoom running. But one thing I wanted to ask in terms of the timing is, and it's eluded me, sorry. I think we've all been, I mean, you've been up probably for quite a long time.
Yeah.
What was I going to ask?
I mean, there is very little lag between, like, it's pretty good. You know, when we see the timer on the split Zoom screen, when you see that ticking over zero, or ticking down to zero to go, and you know, we hear the bell, we see all the other runners running at the same time.
Yeah.
So it seems to be rather seamless when we have Wi-Fi up and our satellite's working.
Yeah. So it was the good old sort of Kiwi number 8, like, scramble to get a solution. And if what's the contingency if the Wi-Fi had dropped out completely, say it had crapped itself for an hour or what have you, what are you looking at then?
Yeah, so what Emma McDowell and I were trying to do is get the spreadsheet on our phones and walk around the forest to try and get some signal, and so we could update it on the phones. And then, you know, we've got our whistle here that if it's not coming through, if the audio goes, then we can start everyone off, and we can run it remotely.
Yeah,
we don't need the Zoom, but it helps.
Yeah, I guess it's that kind of thing. It was quite surreal last night coming down and seeing the Zoom screen and hearing the people talking in different accents and everything like that. But it definitely does help with that sense of connectivity, hey?
Yeah, and you know what they're doing every lap after everyone heads off is, you know, doing a profile of each of the countries, which is pretty cool.
Yeah.
Gets them to tell a little bit about themselves, does some interviews.
Yeah.
There's some pre-made videos that everyone, including the Kiwis, did. So
amazing.
It's quite interesting to see.
Yeah. And how long are you here for?
I'm back to work on Wednesday, so Tuesday night. It depends how long
who
it
knows?
Goes.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
Fantastic. Well, look, thanks for being out, man. It wouldn't happen without you guys holding it down the deck side, so thank you.
You too.
I need to apologise for that little bit of audio where I said in the middle of that talk with Ian Gilmore, I went to ask him a question and then was just, I can't remember what I was going to say. It was hot. We've been up for, you know, not as much as everyone else, but everyone's tired and it was a bit, we were feeling a bit giddy. So look, cut to the chase, Eugene.
Yeah, so as we said at the top of the show, the one and only, the savage from the south, Adam Keane, 35 laps. He was runner-up last year with 28 laps.
Yeah.
So he went considerably deeper this time around. And he took a fairly conservative approach by the looks of it.
Yep.
He had an average of 51.26, fastest lap of 43.58. I mean, you saw him much more than I did. But
he was controlled throughout. Like when he stopped to
relax, wasn't he?
When he stopped to accuse you of like slacking and should, what did he say? There's stuff going on
stuff
in the world.
Going on in the
what
world.
Are you doing here? You know, he was like that the whole time.
Right.
He didn't.
It's his persona, is it?
It is his persona.
Mm.
But he seemed like he was very much in control, and it was really great to see. And likewise, Glenn Sutton. I mean, Glennon,
what hasn't that guy done?
Glenn and Andy Smith, they parked themselves up. They had these collapsible chairs. They were sharing like a pop-up table.
Yeah.
And they had all manner of food and drink and whatever, but they were just – you just – when you're in the presence
yeah.
of people who are just...
I was actually a little bit intimidated when we went over.
100%.
And I realised, oh my God, that's Glenn Sutton.
Yeah, 100%.
I couldn't even say hello to him. I was like, hello.
Yeah. Like, unassuming, wow. polite, yep. wonderful. Yep. And he smashed it out with 34 laps.
34 laps. So, you know, he had a slightly faster average.
Yeah. But was it you saw a comment from his crew?
Yeah, saying that he was fine. Early on, they were saying that he was finding it tough to go slow enough.
Yeah.
And he was getting a bit bored of going around the same area, which, you know, that is part of the whole mental struggle of
Absolutely.
This event, isn't it?
I was thinking I was talking to our girls as we were driving home, and they were saying, oh, what's everyone done? And I said, oh, you know, Glenn Sutton, he's done Badwater. And they're like, what? Lola knew what Death Valley was. But just thinking about, I was saying, you know, people got to run on the white paint on the road and there's all that sort of stuff. But even that, going through Death Valley, there would be some change.
Yeah, well, and you are moving forward all the time.
Yeah,
you're moving forward. Whereas this, you're going around and around and around. but, you know, phenomenal.
Absolutely. And it was hot as all get. I mean, it wasn't as hot as Death Valley. it was hotter than Death Valley. But it was hot. It was still. And then when it started to cool down, I think things started to.
So there was – they were sort of all in there. When I went home, what was that, sort of 14 hours or something, everyone was still in.
Yeah.
It was overnight really that it sort of came unstuck, isn't it? So
well, the sort of you lost Russ, I think.
Not long after I left.
Not long after you left. Yeah. And then he was out like 15 laps, and Damien Wood.
And he was injured.
He was injured. He'd wanted to drop since 9 o'clock. And, you know, we got that audio at the start in the piece with him, and he did his team proud.
Yeah, so, he did. So let's just go back through. So Fiona Havos and Andy Smith, they both made it to 31 laps.
Again, super dialed. Fiona is, you know, she...
What an athlete.
She's granular, right? Yeah. Like her preparation is granular and she was amazing. She was just there vibing.
And that was great to talk to one of her crew.
Yep. Kate Shave.
About that and just get an idea of what it takes to crew and to be, you know, with someone who's as dialed in as Fiona. That's all part of it, isn't it?
Absolutely. It's all part of it. Absolutely. Sean Collins, I mean, he had the added
responsibility.
Yeah, and complexity of not being the race director.
Mm.
But sort of people looked to him as the captain of the ship almost, you know.
He was briefing people. We heard that audio,
as the 3-minute whistle was going.
Yeah. Talking to some guy from Dirt Church Radio.
Dirt Church Radio, he did really well.
Yeah.
So 26 laps. Yep. And this next one, this is the standout performance of the whole thing, and that's Matt Bailey with 25 laps. Like, Matt's been working super hard. He came, he did his first sort of, I think he did his first ultramarathon last time at the relapse. And
really?
Just loved it. He's super positive.
Yeah.
And
good on you, mate.
And just looked in control.
Yeah, went deep. Crispus, the man, the legend, you know.
Yeah.
It was great to meet you, mate.
Absolutely.
23, he had his feet up on your chili bin.
I know, I look a little bit stuck.
You're never going to wash that chili bin.
It's funny to think about it, and it sort of shows the sort of running nerdery, but like absolutely just geeking out and being quite in awe of these people, you know. And
Totally.
Chris Bisley, he was
23 laps.
And hanging out with the dogs that were there too, because he missed his dog. So hanging out with the dogs, it was rad.
Nice. And you know, don't forget, he week before he ran three peaks plus one.
He won it.
Which was 53K or something like that. You know,
absolutely.
So no joke. Not a bad way to taper.
No.
And then of course Katie Wright.
23
laps.
Yep. You can't say she had a bad race because no one had a bad race. I'm sure she would have wanted to have gone longer, and she has gone longer.
So what did she do last year?
She did 30 last year.
Yeah. Obviously, you know, it's a different year.
Absolutely.
It's had its own challenges this year. So phenomenal to go that long. Mike Field, 22 laps. And he, you know, remember he sent us in his greatest run ever the other week.
Absolutely.
And I can imagine that this may well be another one.
Yeah, this comrades one, wasn't it?
Yeah, it was, yeah.
Lap 20 was the carnage.
Yeah.
So you had Ian Evans, who again in the first, you know, probably 15, 16 laps of the race just was so metronomic. He's with, you know, Chris Bisley the whole time. And then he started having a bit of trouble with his calories. And that was kind of what did him in at the end.
Right.
Andrew McDowell, who I think, you know, judging by, you know, they were talking about what he was hurt, what was hurting from very early on. He did amazing.
He had like some sort of bandage.
Apparently that was the least painful part of him.
Oh, really? Wow.
And all the other parts. Yeah. This guy, Michael Stewart, right?
How tough is this?
Michael Stewart's ITB went, right? On the on the 16th lap.
Yeah.
And he came in with like that lap, 59:16, and he actually fell down the little hill, and it's a tiny, it's a step. He fell down there onto the grass.
Because of his ITB.
Got up, ran into the thing. His crew member partner handed him a Big Ben pie.
Yeah.
He scooped it up in his hand and off he went straight out again.
Wow.
The next lap he came through, we could hear him yelling because there's a part of the book where you into the bush. He was roaring, and Lola was going, "Dad, you need to go check on him." I said, "I'm not going to go check on him because he's, you know, no, Dad, you're a nurse. You need to." I'm like, "I'm not going to go check on him."
Yeah.
He just hear this like, "Rah!" out of the bush.
Yeah.
It was echoing. I was like, "No, he'll be fine. He's just working through some things." And then Lola came back and was like, "The people in the cabin say you have to go and check on him because he looks like he's in." But he just came
back,
dumping across, and made it another two laps after that.
Four laps of 59 plus minutes.
Yeah, amazing.
That is mental fortitude.
Absolutely. He was, he was.
And Glenn Kelly did 20 laps as well. So four of them dropped with after 20 laps.
Absolutely.
And then Damien Wood, 16.
Yeah.
You know, and Russ Thomas with 15.
So Damien was struggling in the heat.
Yeah, he was.
And Russ Thomas, I mean, what a Trojan. He was ready to drop at 9 o'clock that morning, he said. Mm, so
Wow. So well done, Team Aotearoa, especially to you, Adam, and Glenn, you know, for take the year, because you can't keep running on your own, can you? So,
absolutely.
So to have the two of you there, both legends, well done. So of course it was a global race. So just to show you how much these things can change. Spain, so 15 runners.
Yep.
At 24 hours, still got all 15 runners.
Yeah, I know. Right? It's
12 hours later, 36 hours, done and dusted. Absolutely. All over. That's amazing, isn't it?
Amazing.
It can just change like that, can't it? Which we saw at Riverhead last year.
Canada looking super strong. Still looking, hopefully super strong. Led by Dave Proctor.
Fast Dave.
Yep, Fast Dave, if we had on the show a couple of times. But he was the second one of the runners out after 24 hours.
Mm.
Again, that's no joke. But, you know, the United States, which had an incredible roster, looking really strong. DeWalter, Gutierrez. You know, the list goes on. They didn't start with Mike Wardian. He's gutted. He's injured. And performer syndrome.
What is that?
My wife has it.
What is that, Ness?
It's something that Mike Wardian and my wife have.
Really?
It's kind of like your side ass gets a bit in it. Yeah, it's a muscle in your
glute,
and it's and it's hard to get to. But
All right. Well, painful. We are recording on Monday night, so let's do a check. We're just going to have a look.
Let's check our temperatures. Let's check the time. And
we're doing this. We're clicking right now, 8:56. So we're coming up to an hour. We might need to
do. Ooh.
Okay, so we've got, look, we've literally just clicked on this.
So as of yard 43, they're currently on yard 43. So Belgium have got three runners. The only one I know out of Belgium is Karel Sabe. So Canada look like they're...
Yeah, I mean, that
there's
looks
one
like
person on.
I guess one. We've still got 3 minutes to the hour.
Yeah, absolutely.
So I guess they're waiting for one more person to come in.
France has got two runners.
Yep. Sweden's got two. The States has got five. Do Walter's still in there?
Yep. Conrad, Moore, Rainwater, and Lewis.
Yep.
Germany with three.
Yep.
Mexico have four.
Four. Oof.
Australia have two.
Australia. Murphy and Loveday still
Murphy
going.
Murphy and Loveday.
Wow.
Yep. And Japan, they've got one runner as well. So
yeah, so that might change by the hour.
We're actually not getting down to the wire because if these people could continue on for another.
Yeah.
20 laps.
That's right. That's right. I mean, it's just, it's, who knows when it's going to end. So, I mean, this is terrible timing. Chris Murphy and Barry Loveday, the Australians there. Wow. Good on yous.
And their average laps are 45 minutes, 15 and 27 respectively. Yep. So, amazing. Yep.
And still Anna Carlson from Sweden, Marina Kalasa from Germany, Courtney Dewalter, Sarah Moore. I think that's Stephanie Simpson. Is she still in?
But, you know, plenty of women still in and amongst it.
Yep. Yep. I said to Gareth, I don't think gender has a place in this thing at all.
Nah.
You can't.
Nah. Nah.
You don't know what's going to happen.
Yeah. But when you scroll down the list and they've got their sort of comments about their previous history. And you get in this one. What's this? Best performance, 67 laps, yep. 22 water.
Spartathlon, UTMB, double-decker Ironman.
Yeah. We might try and slip in a little bit of an update next.
Absolutely.
Before we go out. But anyway, well done to everyone at Team Aotearoa.
Yeah.
Thank you, Matt, for all that recording.
It's my absolute pleasure.
It's beautiful. Thanks to everyone who chatted to us.
Yep. Thank you very much for putting up with us to kind of record in your face.
Yeah. Thanks to Mel for bringing us his special news there.
Absolutely.
Yeah. And thank you to you lot for tuning in.
Yep. We're on social media at Dirt Church Radio. You can email us at dirtchurchradio@gmail.com. You can find us on iTunes, Spotify, Stitcher, and other podcast platforms. And you can download direct from the website, which is dirtchurchradio.com.
Yep. I'm not even going to say that because I always mess it
also,
up every
week. Also, if we're not where you want us to, let us know. Don't forget to subscribe and rate us. Also, if you like what you see, please spread the love. It would be great as if many people heard the show as possible. And for that, we need your help.
It's just a mental thing. Can't do it. Don't forget to send in your greatest run ever. We really love hearing them, and we know that you love hearing them too. So do your fellow listeners a favour and write it down and send it in to us.
Thanks to our sponsors, Scott Running for the fastest, Spring Energy and Cieli. Thank you to our Patreon patrons and Wild Things. Thank you to our editor, Kieran. We've got a great guest lined up for you next week. So tune in then, and ka kite.
Ka kite. Thanks, Rigby.